Good morning, Chardon Assembly of God. Here we are again, meeting online. It's my prayer that you're doing well. Jesus said that where two or three are gathered in his name, that he is in the midst of them. Isn't it good that he said, we only need to be gathered in his name, we don't have to be in the same building? And I believe that it is also the will of God that we happen to live in a time when we have the tools and the technology to come together online. I do want to tell you that Gloria and I miss seeing you and that we are praying that very soon we can be with you in person. Well, before we get into today's message, I would like to take a moment and remember John Hurley. This past week, one of our members, John Hurley, was taken from us. He passed away, but we know that he is today where he belongs. The Bible says that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So today, John is face to face with Jesus. You know, John was one of my favorite people to see at church because he always had a question for me. He was probably one of the most spiritually curious people I've ever known. And it's interesting that today, that every question John has ever had has been answered. You know, I always loved praying with him and for him. And I know that the past couple of years have been physically tough for him, but somehow he managed to be with us every Sunday and Wednesday. So this next week, let's remember to pray for his family. And we're also going to know that someday soon, we're going to be reunited with him. So with all of that in mind, let's get into today's message. But first, I have a story. So it seems that a weasel came through the drive-thru at McDonald's, and a person on the speaker asked, what would you like? Pop, goes the weasel. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can be in your house this morning, that we can worship you, that we can be together in your spirit, and that we just ask that you would be with us as we receive your word, as we hear the message today. And we're praying that very soon we will be able to actually physically be in your house. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we've been going through these really difficult days. And I know that being a Christian and not being able to be with other believers is probably taking its toll. On the other hand, we've had more time to pray and read the Bible. And so this morning, I want to encourage you to keep going. Matthew 24, Jesus said this, but he who endures to the end will be saved. I believe one of the things God wants us to know is just how blessed we are to be Christians. Church, you and I have been saved by the forgiveness of a God who was willing to come and die in our place to take away our sin. We are the blood washed, the set free from sin. We are a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. We are dressed in the righteousness of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are more than conquerors. We are victorious over sin. And the devil no longer has his foot on our throats. In fact, he is under our feet and we are treading over him. We have power over the enemy, and we have overcome by the blood of the Lamb. Chardon Assembly of God is a church built by Jesus that the gates of hell cannot prevail against. That's who we are. We are Christians. I say this all the time, that one of the best decisions I ever made in my life was when I invited Jesus into my life as Lord and Savior. And I believe God has put us here as a church to share the good news. So let's go to Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel lived at the same time as Daniel, during the time of Israel being held captive in Babylon. Now, while Daniel was being used by God in the upper echelons of the kingdom of Babylon, Ezekiel was living among the Jewish exiles. And when you read chapters 1 through 36, God had been using Ezekiel to remind people why they had been taken into captivity. But when we get to chapter 37, Ezekiel begins to tell them how God is getting ready to give them back the promised land. Church, I believe that in many ways we can relate to that circumstance that Ezekiel was in. We're waiting for Jesus to come and take us to our promised land. We've done our time, and now it is time for us to prepare to go to our promised land. So let's begin reading Ezekiel chapter 37, and let's begin at verse 1. It says this, "The hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. And then he caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And so I answered, O God, you know." So as this story begins, Ezekiel saw a vision of a valley that was full of bones. These bones, according to the scripture, were once the people of Israel. So they've been dead for so long that they're skeletons. And their skeletons had been in this valley so long that they were just dry bones. In other words, at this point, there is no sign of life in these people. Let's begin reading at verse 4 again. "Again he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord." See, here's the thing. These bones, these people, were spiritually dead. God told Ezekiel to prophesy to them. Well, you don't prophesy to physically dead people because dead people can't hear you, so it's useless. Church, there comes a time when maybe we've become spiritually dead and dry, and all that we amount to is a pile of bones. Now, before I go on with this story, I want to talk to you about why we become spiritually dead. I want to take you to the book of Hosea, Hosea chapter 13 and verse 1. It says, "When Ephraim spoke, trembling, he exalted himself in Israel. But when he offended through Baal worship, he died. Now they sin more and more, and have made for themselves molded images, idols of their silver according to their skill. All of it is the work of craftsmen. They say of them, let the men who sacrifice kiss the calves. Therefore they shall be like the morning cloud, and like the early dew that passes away, like chaff blown off from the threshing floor, and like smoke from a chimney." This scripture refers to a time when you remember Ahab the king. You probably remember his wife Jezebel. And they led Israel through one of the darkest hours into the worship of Baal. Ephraim was one of the most powerful men in Israel. Matter of fact, it is said that when he spoke, people shook under his power. But finally, he too submitted to the worship of Baal. And when he did, the Bible says he died. And the sin of idol worship became even worse. When Israel worshiped Baal, they died spiritually. Okay, so I know that some of you are going to say, hey, I don't worship other gods. But here's the thing. You do worship other things, which is the same thing. Here's how that happens. It actually is really simple. Other things just become more important. The cares of life seem to take over. And the Bible says these kind of things lead to spiritual death. In Proverbs 21 and 16, it says, "A man who wanders from the way of understanding will rest in the assembly of the dead." Another way that we can die spiritually is that we move away from the Word of God. Whatever the reason, we sometimes just dry up spiritually. And let me tell you, it isn't always that big sin. Because we may still be praying. We might even still be reading the Bible. We still might even go to church. But it just becomes a matter of going through the motions. Things become old or maybe comfortable, and we get into this routine. Church, I want to tell you, God has way more for us than that. So when God tells Ezekiel to prophesy to the bones, and he does, something begins to happen. This is verse 5. "Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you and bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and then you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied there was a noise, and suddenly a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them. So you see here, all the bones come together, all the body parts came together, the muscles began to form, the skin came back, and they look like bodies are supposed to look, but there was something missing, breath. Church, we have to do more than look good to be alive. I've been to a lot of funerals, and surprisingly, one of the things that I hear at almost every single funeral is how good the person who has died looks. You know, you can look good lying there in your casket, but you're still dead. Let's go on with verse 9. But he also said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So as I prophesied, as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood up on their feet, an exceedingly great army. So God tells Ezekiel to prophesy again, but this time he tells him to prophesy to the breath. So Ezekiel calls to the four winds to bring breath to these dead people. Church, we are very blessed to be living in the days when the Spirit is blowing around the earth. The winds always represent the Holy Spirit, and when the Spirit breathes in us, we come to life. Now, I know I've said this often, but we need the Holy Spirit because He brings life. You know, if you go to the hospital, there are two places that you can go to see this. If you go to the morgue, not much is happening there because dead people don't do much. But if you go to the nursery, there is a lot of activity. Why? Because babies are noisy, they're moving around, they cry, they fuss, and the people who work in the nursery are always busy because there's so much activity. That's the way it is in a church that is alive. And suddenly, sadly, so many people come to church and that's when they decide they want to be somber and serious. But when the Spirit comes in, He brings life and things are going to happen. Listen, I don't know about you, but I want to go to a church that is alive where there is something happening. And guess what? It might get a little noisy because where there is life, there is noise. So those bodies came together, but there is more. Not only did they come to life, but they also, it says, were an exceeding mighty army. You see, a believer who is filled with the Holy Spirit is more than alive. They are a mighty force to be reckoned with. Verse 11. And then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. And they indeed say, our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off. Right now, I want to tell you the enemy is doing everything he can to kill the spiritual life of the church. You know, even before this virus began, people had stopped going to church, and I don't know why God is letting this attack come upon us, but I'm convinced the devil would like nothing more than to try to take away the life of the church during this time when we can't be together. Satan wants you to feel cut off, but God has something to say about that in verse 12. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. And then you shall know I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from their graves. I will put my spirit in you and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land, and then you shall know that I am the Lord, have spoken it and performed it. I believe every word of this will begin to happen once we can come together again as a church. And I'm praying that once the church is able to be together, that we will never again take for granted our time in the house of God. I expect that we might even see a great revival as now we've gained a new appreciation for what it means to open our church and worship with each other. I mean, we might have to be 6 feet away, and some of us might have to wear masks. But truthfully, none of that matters, because all we need is the breath of the Holy Spirit blowing from the four corners of the earth, ushering in the very presence and the power of the living God. You know, as I was reading this and hear the noise and these bodies coming together, it reminded me of another passage from the New Testament, 1 Thessalonians 4 and chapter 4 and verse 16. It says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord." You know, we are closer than we have ever been. Our days of bondage are almost over. Our time of separation is coming to an end. Not only our time of being separated from each other, but our time of being separated from those who have gone on before. Think of how great it will be when in just a couple of weeks we can come together again as a church. But even beyond that, how incredible will it be when we're finally reunited with each other in heaven? And that is the good news that I have for you today. Father, we thank you that we can be in your with your people, and we can't be in your house physically, but we can be in your house spiritually. And Father, I pray for those who need encouragement today. I ask that you would lift them up. Those who need healing, that you would bring healing to their bodies. I thank you that we get to be a part of a church that is alive. Even though we can't be together, we are still alive. And we thank you, Lord, because we know that we're coming to an end of this separation. And we just ask that you would continue to bless. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me once again thank you for your continued financial support of the church. Also, I just want to tell you to be expecting some kind of an announcement, maybe even as soon as this week, about when we can get back together as a church. We're going to be getting some clarification this week about how soon we can make that happen. So be ready, because I believe that it won't be too much longer we're going to be able to be back together in our church again. As always, if you need prayer, you can call, text, or email. I'm here for you. God bless you. Have a great week. You'll probably be hearing from me this week about our future plans, and we will be putting together another message on Wednesday. So until then, stay well, stay blessed, and stay home. Bye.